spirit and emailed it to me. It was waiting for me, I believe, this morning. Being strengthened, reading out of the NIV, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might. Anybody want to get in that line tonight? I want to get in the line where it's strengthened by his mighty power. Amen. I want to be in the lineup for those who are recipients of his glorious might, so that, not just power for power's sake, but so that you may have great endurance and patience and joyfully giving thanks to the Father. Listen to this tonight, my brothers, my sisters, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. We checked it in the New King James. It says to be partakers of the inheritance. Tonight there is fellowship after the service. All of you are hoping I'll remember that. And when we open up the table tonight, and when we say, come, be a partaker, something is prepared for you. It was intended for you. It wasn't intended for somebody in Montreal. We didn't make that bannock. We didn't make that for somebody that isn't here. But instead of that, something has been prepared with you in mind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you are a partaker. Hallelujah. God says there's an inheritance. She gets into my notes. I don't know how she does it. She walks up here tonight and begins to sing, I'm a child of the King. And I'm going, yep, she's in my notes again. And so now, go back with me to the book of Genesis. God is part two for Benjamin. Benjamin, you did not just get rescued at the time of your birth. Your father did not just step in and change your name in Genesis 35, but turn with me tonight to Genesis 49. What is going to be the inheritance of this tiny little baby? Jacob is left now with this 12th son. The younger son, the only full-blood son of Joseph. The baby, Benjamin. The father has already said, I will define your future. Folks, I want tonight God to define my future, don't you?
Amen.
I want God to not only define my future, but it says in Colossians, that he is releasing his mighty power on me that I can become a partaker of my destiny. So we're not just trying. We're not just tiptoeing and saying, devil, could you just scoot out of the way? I thought I'd get past you and get to my destiny. No, God says, I have pledged myself to you. Oh. You must have used up all your amen this weekend. Okay, ladies, you don't have to say amen. All the men have to say amen tonight. And so we begin to find out what's going to be the inheritance. This little baby. Why the change, Pastor Alex? Why the cross? Why the power of the blood? Why the name in the Lamb's Book of Life? Why the calling? Why the endowment of power? I got part of the answer. There's an inheritance that the Father ordained for Benjamin. Now, chapter 49, Jacob is now an old man. He's about to die. And he lays hands on each of those boys. Have I done 12 yet? All the way down, his 12 sons. And he gets to Benjamin. And we might say tonight, so does God have anything left for me? Does God have anything left for me? And the answer is yes. I realize tonight that a number of you, as you are hearing this message, you never have your natural father speak blessing on you. There's a number of you sitting here tonight. We could go up and down these rows. I could ask you, did your father ever say, Kathy, I see you as my beloved daughter, and as I lay my hands upon you, I impart to you? My father, and I gave you my family testimony, my father, he had much in his heart, but it never made it to his mouth. And I want all of the men to hear me for just a moment. Men in this room, your words mean everything to your sons and your daughters. It is absolutely true. Your words, and I never knew, was my dad glad I was saved? Was he glad that I got really good grades? Was he glad? I used to play the clarinet in the school band. I was not a very good clarinet player. I actually think I was supposed to be in the percussion system. I love that tambourine, okay. And sometimes my dad would not even bother to come to the school concerts. Now, I didn't have a mother. She died when I was 11. So dad would drop me off. Drop me off. And I would sit there and play the clarinet. And sometimes I just wanted to make a really nasty bad note. Now, why would I want to do that? Because it didn't matter anyway. My dad wasn't there. Are you following me tonight? I long for my dad to say, honey, I'm so proud of you. I'm so glad. But it was in his heart, but it never made it to his mouth. And I encourage the fathers in this room, take it from your heart and put it in your mouth and say it and say it and say it to your children. Well, when I was in Bible school, my dad hadn't come to Jesus yet. He wasn't a believer. Very nice man, but he wasn't a believer. And he gave me this ring. And I absolutely, to this day, love this ring. And whenever I look at, not every time I look at the ring, but this ring means something to me, Pastor, because this ring is every word my dad never said. This ring is a loud message from this guy. And it will be, to finish the story, it'll be 42 years this June, okay? Woo! So this ring carries a real message, but so does this ring. But unfortunately, and yet fortunately, but the unfortunate thing is, this ring is all of the words my daddy never said. When Dad did get saved, it was so precious. And my dad used to practice, love you, honey. And I'd call and he'd say, oh, hi, how are you doing? And he loved Jack so much. That was a great joy. And we would come home and see him We had the privilege of being at his bedside when he went home to be with the Lord. It was a great day. Not because he died, but because he went to heaven. Glory! But Jacob's got 12 boys to bless. So what's he going to say? And the first time I read this about Benjamin, I thought, you know what, I'm not going to preach that. Let's go to the next one. I thought, nobody's going to be happy about this word. Jacob, is that the best you can do for your baby boy? Until finally the Holy Spirit took me back to Genesis 49. And it says in verse 27, Benjamin is a ravenous wolf. See what I mean? Nobody's going to be happy about that. Nobody's going to say amen to that. Benjamin is a ravenous wolf. Unless, of course, you were at Moosonee Pentecostal Assembly on Sunday. And unless, of course, Pastor Alex called you up and said, women, come up here and fight. Mm-hmm. Pastor, you were giving the introduction to the message. Hallelujah. Holy Ghost is in this service tonight. Hallelujah. And he began to speak over that baby boy. And when he imparted something, for these are words. This is an impartation from the heart of the Father, and not just Father Jacob, but Father God. Hallelujah. And he begins to say, he said, Benjamin, you are a ravenous wolf. And you go, whoa, whoa, whoa. And then he goes on and he says, in the morning, he devours the prey. And in the evening, he divides the plunder. Holy Spirit began to deal with me, and he said, you go back to that verse. I said, okay, what are you saying? He said, I am declaring over Benjamin that he is not going to be the prey of the enemy. Good so far. But he will plunder the enemy's camp.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. I said, God, I'm in. I'm going to get in that line up too. Lay your hands on me, God. Lay your hands on me. Because I want to go out and I want to go in the morning and not to pick up what the enemy has torn the church apart. Torn the confidence apart, wrecked the expectation of God's people. But I want to be one who goes in the morning and says, okay, devil,
yes,
hand it over.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah.
I am here to enforce the authority of God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Anybody want in on it tonight? So I have an impartation tonight that I've been sent to Moosonee. We just came from Keshechewan. These women in Keshechewan have been my prayer partners all day. I called them aside and I said, okay, ladies, we're going for it. We're going to take Moosonee. Come on. They've been praying about today with me. I say this to every believer in this room. Find your fight. Well, oh, I don't know what you were expecting. It went awfully quiet. But I am declaring over God's people tonight, there is a spirit of victory and a conquering spirit inside of you that you have not even yet discovered. Hallelujah. Woo, glory. It's yours. It isn't just, well, and funny. No, no. It's, we do not war after the flesh. This is after the spirit. And God has promised me tonight that he is going to pierce through passivity. The spirit of passivity clouds us over like a film, so our eyes cannot see, like a fog. At the guest house where we are your guests, we get to choose our coffee every morning, different names. One of them is called the fog lifter. And I thought, oh, if I could give everybody in this room a cup of that. And so we would pass the cup tonight, and that fog of passivity would be broken off of you in the name of the Lord. You see, part of the work of the enemy is just to sway us into thinking nothing will ever change. It always will be that way. It's always been that way. There'll never be anything different. That's just the way it is. That's just the way it is. And tonight, in the authority of the anointing of God's Spirit, I break that passivity.
Yes,
off of the body of Christ. I pierce it with truth tonight. And I declare, find your fight.
Hallelujah.
I declare it over our young people. I am not calling you to be rude and obnoxious and hard. And nobody says, oh man, get out of the way. There's one of them. But I want you to make the devil nervous. I want you to begin to be known as one who plunders the camp of the enemy. What does it mean to plunder? I've been going through, and actually I preached a series of messages that over and over again God says, an anointing came on one of his servants, and they plundered the enemy. The plunder. One of the times recently that we preached this was right before Christmas. And I was preaching it that morning. And I was preaching not this verse, but out of Chronicles, where it says that there was so much plunder, it took them 3 days to pick it up. 3 days to gather up what was previously on the enemy. They took it off the enemy. The enemy was slain by the power of God. It took them 3 days to pull their wagons, as it were, and take the plunder. And pastor, after the service, pastor said, meet us over here for lunch. Small town. We drove to that place, parked the car, went down the sidewalk, parked outside of the restaurant was a wagon. I said to Jack, must be where the pastor is. Even has his wagon here. He's going to take some plunder all over town. So I say to you tonight, Benjamin, you will not be the prey of the enemy. The enemy will be your prey. Hallelujah. You are going to reach in. And those things that the enemy wanted to devour, you will say, no. And anointing come up upon you. And things that you have tolerated, you will say, no. No more. That's the end. No longer will you prey upon my family. But you're in trouble now, enemy. Because I just found out part of my inheritance is to gather plunder from the enemy. Church, why don't you put your hands together and just praise him tonight. Lord, I release a holy fight upon God's people to the glory of God. Go with me now to the next one. It's in Deuteronomy. Verse 33, chapter 33. Jacob, he is now gone. This is the forward generations carrying Benjamin's name. Chapter 33 of Deuteronomy. It is the blessing that Moses, the man of God, is about to pronounce upon every tribe. These are the descendants of Benjamin. Folks, do you picture it with me tonight? While you were praying, God was speaking to our sister from right in the same psalm where I was praying. And God was saying to her, there's a wilderness that's going to be shaken by the voice of God. If I understand correctly, that where they are camped in Deuteronomy 33 is in that wilderness. And if I understand the Bible right, previous generation had gotten right to that line, made the wrong decision, and turned around, and never saw their inheritance. But God has found a new generation. They have been 40 years in the wilderness, but they are brought in God's plan right back to the border line of their promise. Hallelujah. They're right there, Sister Peggy. They're lined up. No longer are they carrying a shovel. You say, what do you mean? For 40 years, they had lived in a death culture. Can you imagine? We have one funeral, and then if we have two right together, you know how it makes the whole community feel? For 40 years, they went out every morning, gathered their manna, picked up their shovel, and buried the corpses. 40 years, their shovel was busy burying unbelief. And yet God was so good. In the middle of that kind of atmosphere, the hour came when God said, lay down your shovel and pick up your sword. And I was sitting there tonight just enjoying the music, enjoying the testimony and song, enjoying the declaration in music, and all of a sudden I just heard God say, lay down your shovel and take up your sword. And I feel that's a word in this house tonight. You have had many, many times where you've had to bury unbelief, disappointments. You've had to bury them. But God speaks to you tonight and says, lay down your shovel. That season is over. Anybody want to be happy? Lay down your shovel. That season is over. Pick up your sword. It's time. It's time to take your inheritance. On a Sunday night many years ago, oh, I love to tell this story. Because if I tell the story, I'm telling it on myself. We preached in the morning, two services. It was snowing, it was November. We drove to the about 100 kilometers, got to the next church, preached our hearts out three times that Sunday. At the end of the service, all I could think about was thank God we don't have to drive home in the snow. We're going to stay right down the road at this lovely hotel, guests of the church. Wow, I preached three times. The anointing has lifted and everything underneath is wrinkled. It's not how I'm feeling tonight. And so I finished preaching and I turned it over to the pastor. And the anointing hits, actually it was the pastor's wife. The anointing hits the pastor's wife. And she said, right now. And I thought, oh, here we go. I mean, I was glad, but I was tired. And I thought, you take it, sister. I'm on my way to the moon. And so she lights them all up, and the Spirit of God falls, and they're blessed, they're receiving, and I'm ready to, okay, it's done. And the pastor, the anointing hits the pastor. The pastor says, right now, he said, those of you, even in the back, he said, God is saying, come from the outside to the inside. That was a good word. But I thought, well, God bless the pastor. And so the pastor, he's under the anointing. And people get up and they're weeping and they're lining the church. And it was like from there to there in about one third again. And I thought, oh, there's lots of people. I'm tired. I'm ready to leave. And so I just stood back. And all of a sudden, yes, it was the pastor. He said, get in there and pray for him. I thought, with what? I'm all wrinkled. I have anything left. But he is the pastor, and I'm supposed to follow the pastor. So I went up, and lining up across the front, I was walking in the front, and there stood a tall blonde lady. She was almost as tall as you, sir. And she stood there. And while I was walking up to her, now I've already told you how I didn't feel I had anything left to give. But the pastor said to pray, so I'm going to pray. And so I walked up to her and I heard a song. So I walked up to her and I said, ma'am. Oh, and she was real excited because the speaker was going to pray for her if she owned me. And so I said, while I was approaching you, I heard a song. And she goes, yes. And she's excited. Yes. And I said, I'm going to sing that song. She was ready. And I raised my hand, and I laid my hand up on her shoulder, and I began to sing. How much is that doggy in the window? Because that was the song the Lord gave. And I'm thinking, God, if you don't come through, this is a mess. And I'm singing it, and all of a sudden, Spirit of God, who was not wrinkled, he was not tired, he was not depleted, Spirit of God says, you have waited and watched at the window, and you have looked in until you know what your heart desires. And it is good that you have said, how much is the cost? Because the Lord says to you, tonight is the night. Go through the door and find what you desired and what you have longed for. Tonight is yours. Hallelujah! I cannot tell you, sir, how relieved I was. And I was energized. I thought, boy, if God has that, I wonder what he's got for the next one. So and she said, wait, come back here. And I came back and she said, it would interest you to know I am a professional dog trainer. How does God do that? Because God is really good at speaking so personally and to let you know he knows what you've set your heart on. So what is Moses going to say over Benjamin? Is he going to say in verse 12 about Benjamin, you're just the runt? No, 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 no. Hallelujah. About Moosonee, the Lord says. About Waswanapi, the Lord says. About Keshechewan, the Lord says. It's as if tonight the Lord is saying, Alex Gunner, about Alex Gunner, I say. Let the beloved of the Lord rest. Secure in him, for he shields all day long. And the one the Lord loves rests between his shoulders. It's a precious anointing by the Spirit right now. There's a message from the heart of God. And God is saying, if you are ever going to possess your inheritance, like Colossians says, like was in the heart of the Father when he changed your name, then you must have the revelation that you are loved. This is not for wimps. You say, oh, it's that www, sweet, cozy stuff. Sister Peggy, did you forget this isn't the women's conference? This is Sunday night church. Oh, it's for every one of us. This is the word spoken over Benjamin when he was ready to go across that line and to enter in to everything God had ready for him. Woo, glory! And he said, the premise to being a conqueror is to know that you are loved. To know that you are resting secure between his shoulders. I gotta find me one of these little kids to help me preach. Nan is our little... Okay. Is he asleep? I would love to have him get him. Is there one of the men that he's really comfortable that he would allow to hold him? Okay, so you're on. Come on up. She's gonna go get our preacher, little preacher helper downstairs. He's got Benjamin. I want you to see this. Because the Holy Ghost, I was standing there tonight and I said, God, what is there about this service that you ordained that this would be one of the last services before we go to India? And the Holy Spirit said, I'm filling you with a song and a spirit of a conqueror. I have declared it that there are mountains and there are valleys. I'm voting for just mountains in Asia. However, I have battled some of the demonic spirits, particularly of Sri Lanka. I have faced off with those. Oh, here come the preachers, right? So I think this will work if you turn and you kind of hold him comfortably, cuddling between your shoulders. It's not because I'm weak. It's not because I'm fragile. It's not because I'm blow in the wind, knock me over, knock me out. Cute. We practiced for 2 hours, didn't we? Oh, we practiced. Okay. And no, oh no, we're just kidding. prophetically positioned you for. For God says, about my conquering servants of Husani, they will rest secure between my shoulders. They are my beloved. Is the Holy Ghost showing you that to me? Are you receiving what the Holy Ghost is showing you? So I was asking the Lord, now this is more difficult, so we practiced this one for 3 hours. I was looking at this, and the Holy Spirit said, there's another place on the Father's back between the shoulders. I said, oh God, that's fun.
Feet in front. He's riding on your shoulders.
Here we go. It's so much fun. I'm stiff as a board. God enjoys you. I want to speak that over this room tonight. The Father is not just putting up with you, but the Father says, I enjoy my child. Every chance I get, if I could do it, I would gather you up, I would put you on my shoulders. I would carry you. I would just run through the middle of the enemy's troops, and I would say to the enemy, nah, 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 to get him, you got to get through me. Hallelujah. Oh, glory be to God. Oh, glory. The two of you are great preachers. Hallelujah. Wait just a moment, Father. Father, what you have showed us tonight through the Word of God, but pictured for us through this little life who does not want to look at me, we declare tonight, not only with this child, we have conquered, that this child shall know and have the revelation of the strength of the Father's arms. And this one who has carried him tonight will be like a sign from the Heavenly Father that he is beloved and he is secure. And let the house say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. That's yours because you are his. This is not for weak ones. Not for the wicked, it's for the spirit of conquerors. If you are a conqueror tonight, then your privileged position is to rest between your father's shoulders, both sides, here and here. It's not all, one more. Psalm 68. Oh, we're on the drums. I need lots of help preaching tonight. We are going to need a holy cadence. We're about to experience the presence of God coming like a mighty parade, like a procession. Are you in for that? Go prophesy on those drums. All right, we're about to hear it. He closes the door. He puts on the earphones. Come on. And Benjamin is about to be prophesied. Psalm 68, many of you have prayed this. Let God arise. Let his enemies be scattered. You have prayed, let your enemies melt like wax before the Lord. Intercessors all over this room, you prayed this over your communities. And the chapter goes on. And the wording is different in different versions, so you're going to have to trust me tonight. But I think we all have the same wording in about verse 24. Your procession has come into view, O God. The procession of my God and King into the sanctuary. In front are the singers, after them the musicians. With them are the maidens playing tambourines. Praise God in the great congregation. Praise the Lord in the assembly of Israel. Oh, look at verse 27. But before we do that, do it again, my friend, do it again. River, as if the Lord, the Almighty King, was bursting through that back door. Go! Had a vision while she was praying for mercy. She saw the Lord in beautiful white, like fur, like ermine. And she saw him entering in to the area. And she saw the might and the power. And he was huge. And he was victorious. And there was just a procession of his glory. She did not know that I'd be preaching Psalm 61. Your procession has come into view, oh God. But did you read on to the next verse? Verse 27. There, the little tribe of Benjamin leading them. Oh, come on, church. I don't know why you aren't jumping all around. The mighty procession. It does not say, surely somebody out in Edmonton will lead the procession. It does not TV evangelists. Oh, it's okay, they're involved. But God said, those that will lead my procession are the little tribe of vengeance. Thank you, my friend. Thank you very, very much. Tonight, I declare there is more leadership in this room than you realize. You were not meant to be the tail. You were meant to be the head. But there is no arrogance in that. There is no self-elation, elevation in that. For this is not my parade. This is not your parade. It's not your parade. It's not your parade. It's not your parade. Your parade. Your parade. It is the procession of our God and King. Hallelujah!
Yes.
Oh, and who has the honor to lead? The little tribe of Benjamin. Oh, we are so honored tonight to bear his name. We were the ones that were supposed to be Benoni. We were the ones that the devil said, gotcha! Till the Father stepped in. And now, Benjamin, take your place. Benjamin, take your place. Benjamin, take your place. Benjamin, take your place.
Ooh, Jesus.
Benjamin, take your place. For the little tribe of Benjamin shall be them. Father, we cry out tonight as the psalmist did, for he had a vision. The psalmist had a revelation and said, my God is not just a minor player.
No, Dad.
My God is not just a limited God, but my God is one who will summon his power as he has done before. Father, I am standing in Lucene tonight declaring this word. There are witnesses in this room from Peshawar. There are witnesses in this room from Waswanipi. There are those in this room who have seen your power in a previous hour. But we declare tonight your procession again is coming into you. If you believe that tonight, and I call out over Benjamin all over this room, stand to your feet. Say, I'm gonna take my place, for I am Benjamin. I'll stand up tonight, I'll take my place.